I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Merwin Gerard's study of a man pursued. Dead Man's Tale. Starring George Maharis. Craig Stevens. And Charles McGraw. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour. Guilt is not something that can always be determined in a court of law. One must first consider the source. Carl Brooks is a man well acquainted with guilt. It drove him first from his home, then drew him back and into a situation for which he was totally unprepared. His best friend had been convicted and executed for murder. Only Carl's testimony could have saved him. So the guilt is now a matter of omission, a matter of moral negligence. And for Carl Brooks, the guilt is more imposing than ever. The man he left behind, in turn, left a widow and child. Someone is sending them money. Carl Brooks would like to find out who and why. Dead Man's Tale continues after this word.
I watched the sun come up over the city from my hotel window. The first light of day peeked over the eastern horizon at 5 o'clock, then fanned out over the stockyards, the industrial section, and crept into downtown. By 5:30, sunlight glistened off the facings of glass skyscrapers. The street lamps shut off. The morning edition hit the newsstands. City buses rolled down the avenues from dark to dawn to day. Hadn't shut my eyes or my mind all night. If I was to accomplish anything this day, I would first have to freshen up. A weary face with dark circles under the eyes peered out at me from the medicine chest mirror. Oh, come on. Can't believe it. This is Mr. Brooks in room 610. What happened to the water? Or doesn't that come with the price of the room?
I'm terribly sorry, sir. We've had some trouble with the boilers, and we've temporarily shut off all the water in the east wing.
That's just great. How do you propose your paying guests wash?
We hope to have the service restored sometime this afternoon, sir.
What about the west wing?
Actually, sir, you're better off where you are. We'll be shutting off the water on the other side after the noon hour today. We're sorry for the inconvenience. We have a repair crew working full time.
Yeah, well, I'd like another room.
As you wish, sir. West wing?
Yes, west wing.
I can give you a fifth floor suite. It's $5 a day more than you're paying now.
Well, I'll take it.
Very well, sir. It's room 519.
Yes, oh, wait a minute, your rooms are separated by odd and even numbers, right?
Yes, sir.
Well, I'd like room 515.
Well, I'm sorry, sir. We have no room 515.
No 515?
No, sir. We converted that room to storage space 4 years ago.
I see. 519 will be fine, then.
Very good, sir. I'll transfer your bill starting today.
Clerk.
Yes,
were there any calls for me after midnight?
One moment. No messages at all, sir.
Thank you. I took the elevator down to the lobby and exchanged the keys. So 515 was only used for storage now. That had been for 4 years. Very strange coincidence. A man is killed in the room. Another man is condemned for murder and rushed off to meet his maker, and suddenly, the scene of the crime no longer exists. 525. 523. 21. And here it is, 519. I wonder. Just as he said. No room number. Storage, employees only. I showered, shaved, and had a light breakfast in the coffee shop before leaving the hotel. I needed mobility for the errands I had to run, so I rented a late model sedan from an auto agency. I phoned the Chronicle and tried to reach Hugo again. But he was out on still another story. Either that, or his secretary was told to say he was. Ellen Wilson's financial status was foremost in my mind. Nameless donations and free medical care. Dr. Frank Irwin might be able to shed some light on the subject, I thought. I drove to County General Hospital to find him. Dr. Irwin was in County General, all right, as a patient. The previous night, he had run his car into a telephone pole and had suffered minor injuries. Fortunately, I arrived during visiting hours, and the nurse told me that Dr. Irwin had been lightly sedated, but I could see him for a short time.
Edna, I'm sorry. I should have been more careful.
Dr. Irwin?
Oh, I thought you were Edna. She's been away visiting her sister.
My name is Carl Brooks.
I see. I thought you were... Edna's my wife. She's been after me to get some rest, day off once in a while. Are you from the police?
No, sir.
See, I had a little accident with the car last night.
Oh.
I fell asleep at the wheel. Unspeakable for a doctor.
Yeah, are you feeling better?
I can't feel a thing. Wonder drugs, we call them. You look familiar. You one of my patients from long ago?
No, sir, I'm Carl Brooks from long ago.
Oh, why, of course. I heard you were back.
Hasn't everyone?
I'm so glad you're here.
Well, that's a switch.
I'm afraid I don't understand. You are the man who's helping Ellen Wilson, aren't you?
Well, I'm a friend of her.
I know all about you, Mr. Brooks.
Oh?
I want to do all I can to help you. Say, would you mind bringing me that pitcher of water right there?
Oh.
Can't seem to work up a spit. Thank you. I don't want to dry up before I say what has to be said.
Doctor, Ellen Wilson is one of your patients, isn't she?
Has been, ever since she first moved here. Must have been, near 10-15 years ago. When she got married and had the baby, I became what we used to call a family doctor.
Have you been sending Ellen Wilson money?
Money? No, that must be one of the others.
Others?
Please, the water.
Oh. What others?
Well, I don't know who they are. I think the man who runs the big gambling club in town is one of them.
Joe Farris.
Yeah, that's who I mean, Joe Farris. He's a horrible man.
Doctor, I don't want to sound like a lawyer. I mean, I've given that up, but if you don't know who the others are, would you know why anyone is sending Ellen Wilson money?
I'm a doctor, Mr. Brooks. It's my sworn duty, my sacred obligation to save lives. I committed a breach of honor 4 years ago in a court of law. Because I was afraid of the disgrace, I did nothing to prevent the execution of an innocent man.
Barry Wilson.
That's right.
Could you have saved him?
Perhaps. No. The point is, I didn't even try. Oh, that's fine.
Well, what could you have done or said?
Well, I don't know why I ever got involved. Edna begged me not to. She's always right about that sort of thing. Very sound thinker, my wife.
Doctor, what was this involvement?
Oh, ambition, pride, vanity. I wanted to be commissioner of health. And I consoled myself that everybody did it.
Did what?
paid for political favors. There was this Farris and myself and two others. I have no idea who they are. But we each contributed a large sum of cash to a special fund for the re-election of Lloyd Mercer.
Of course. It was so obvious it never occurred to me. That was why Mercer never admitted to there being money in the attaché case. It would have blown his legal eagle image sky high. The fact that I had been a very real part of his political machine turned my stomach.
So you see, Mr. Brooks, I isolated the hypocrite in Hippocrates.
And that's what Henley was carrying.
It would seem so. There was never any proof. The subject never came up.
Well, I understand what Farris was paying for. Protection. But certainly, Commissioner of Health isn't appointed by the district attorney.
Oh, Lloyd Mercer, as we've seen, was headed for bigger things. His political influence extended in all directions. And I was convinced he could deliver. Obviously, so were the others.
I understand there was $150,000 in that briefcase.
I couldn't say. My contribution was $30,000.
And you have no idea who else may have known about this special fund?
As far as I know, only Mercer and the four contributors.
Well, what about Henley? I mean, where did he come in?
I never met the man. I understand he was from out of state. Well, I presume he was chosen as a go-between because he had no connection with any of us.
Including Mercer?
Especially Mercer.
Uh-huh.
I presume Mercer sent you to pick up the lock case so there'd never be any visible connection between himself and Henley. As a precaution against precisely the sort of thing that happened.
You know, it seems so unnecessarily complicated.
Has it occurred to you that whoever murdered Henley might be one of the contributors? I know there were four of us, and not one came forward. Farris wasn't even at the trial.
Doctor, do you believe Barry Wilson was innocent?
I believed it throughout the course of the trial, the appeals, up to the moment of his execution. I believe it as I lie here now. I stood by and let him die.
Doctor, from what you've told me, you were not the only one.
Well, Mr. Brooks, a man has only to live at peace with himself.
I know that better than anyone. I assume that all of Ellen Wilson's medical expenses through the years...
Oh, yes. I was grateful for the opportunity. It helped. A little.
You've helped a lot, Doctor. You get well now, and I'll be in touch.
All right.
I left the hospital and headed for the National City Bank, Ellen Wilson's branch. It didn't take me long to notice I was being followed. A big maroon late model touring car was smoking along behind me. Obviously dragging. Too obvious to be anything but a message from Joe Farris. Looking in my rearview window, I could see two men in the car with the brims of their hats pulled low over their foreheads. It would have been funny if it weren't so frightening. And I was sure that was the purpose. To scare me into running. I had done it once before. Why not again? But Dr. Irwin had answered that for me. A man has only to live at peace with himself. And I was determined to achieve that. I stopped in front of the bank. Farris's thugs drove on. They knew where I was going and who I wanted to see. We were all beginning to understand each other all too well. I began to feel the need for some protection of a different kind. Dead men tell no tales. It was time to leak some information to the press.
City desk. Brownell here.
Hugo, I waited all night for your call.
Oh, what do you want?
Look, I think a lot more went on in the Henley case than we were led to believe.
We were led to believe?
Now, come on, Hugo. I mean, just... give me a chance and just hear me out.
Look, I'm interested in facts. Hard facts. Something I can put in print.
Well, I've learned enough in one day to know that you were right about Barry being framed and about the political setup in this town.
So? Now there's two of us.
Look, I want to talk to you.
Do you or don't you have something I can print without risking a libel suit?
Well, look, I will in about 15 minutes.
I'll listen when you do. I'm much too busy now for idle conversation, so you can
Look, Hugo, wait. No, wait. I've just got to see you. Today, in an hour. In an hour. I think we'll find something in the back issue of the Chronicle. I'll meet you there.
Carl? Carl! Damn it. Shirley, I'll be in the morgue. The one with the dead papers.
May I be of service, sir?
Yes. I'd like to speak to the branch manager. Well?
Go ahead. I'm waiting.
Oh.
I'm Joanne Price, branch manager. What can I do for you?
Well, I'm sorry. I didn't...
You didn't think a woman could ever achieve a position of responsibility, especially in such a stuffy field as money management. Believe me, I felt the same way. It's been a struggle.
A depositor of yours, Mrs. Ellen Wilson, has been receiving cashier's checks drawn on this bank in the amount of $100 each month for the past 4 years. I'd like to know who's been sending them.
Won't she tell you?
She doesn't know either.
Does she object?
Mrs., can't you just tell me who's sending those checks?
No, I'd like to. You have such an honest face. But I'm afraid even if I had that information, it would be confidential. Besides, I'm really only the hired help. I wouldn't have the authority to give it to you.
Well, who would?
The bank president, Mr. Lacey.
Ah, well, may I talk to him?
I don't think it'll do you any good.
Why not?
Mr. Lacey's a Scrooge, the tightest man on earth, with money and with words.
Look, could you ask him if he'd see me, please?
Don't hold your breath.
Well?
The sun sets in the east tonight. He'll see you. All the way at the back. Don't say anything, but I'm bucking for his job.
Well, I hope you get it. Thank you very much.
Come in and close the door behind you.
Mr. Lacey?
I only let you in here to tell you face to face that what you're asking for is privileged information. And I demand to know what your authority is in seeking it and for what purpose.
I have reason to believe the person signing those cashier checks may have committed murder.
Are you from the police?
No.
Certainly murder would be a matter for them.
All right, Mr. Lacey. If you'd rather I take what I already know to the police.
You're Carl Brooks.
That's correct.
Mr. Brooks, I'm not a rich man, despite what you may think.
You knew Barry Wilson was innocent, didn't you?
I don't know that.
Is there reasonable doubt?
Maybe. I've done nothing illegal.
Well, somebody has. Someone killed Robert Henley for $150,000, some of which, I think, was yours, Mr. Lacey.
You can't believe I'd kill a man for money.
Well, you said yourself you're not a rich man.
Now, just a damn minute.
Look, I'm only going to ask you one more time, Mr. Lacey, because if you don't tell me, I'll find out somewhere else. It may save us both a lot of unnecessary trouble, and it might even make you feel better now. Do you know who is sending $100 cashier checks once a month to Ellen Wilson?
No, I don't. And should you have any further inquiries into my personal affairs, Mr. Brooks, I suggest you make them through my attorney. Good day. Get me Judge Mercer's chambers, immediately.
Lacey was the kind of man who revealed more in a facial reaction than by anything he could have said. He was undoubtedly the third donor. Farris, Dr. Irwin, and Lacey. But who was the fourth? I left the bank and walked to my rented car. The tires were flat. All of them. Slashed. I looked up and down the street. There was no sign of the big maroon car, but the meaning was clear. So I had to get to the Chronicle building right away. I had to get to Hugo Brownell.
Oh, Hugo, you're here.
Don't ask me why. I guess I'm just a sucker for nostalgia.
Well, I wasn't sure if I'd make it. Word is out on me.
What do you mean?
Farris had his boys cut up my tires on the car. I hitchhiked over here. Never thought you'd come.
Look, Carl, you're raving. Come on, you got me down here for a reason. Let's have it.
Hugo, what do you know about a special campaign contribution fund to get Lloyd Mercer elected to a second term as DA?
Maybe I should ask what you know.
Well, there was one. $150,000. And that's what Henley was carrying the night he was murdered.
Can you prove it?
Not only that, but I think I can prove who killed Henley.
Who? Do you know?
Well, I'm hoping you can remember. You've seen him. You may even know him.
You lost me.
Look, four people contributed to Mercer's special fund. It was Farris and Dr. Irwin, the president of the National City Bank, a man named Lacey.
Mm-hmm. First name, Clarence. A big man in contract financing, bit on the shady side. That's only three.
Well, there should be the name of a picture of the fourth somewhere in these files.
Well, that could take days to find.
Not if you can remember.
Remember what?
Well, someone who was at Barry's trial, someone who was there every day.
Carl, this is hopeless. Even if we find who you're looking for, we'd have to push to reopen the case. And you know whose court this is. We'd have a hell of a time trying to get anybody to confess to being...
Hold on. I found something.
What do you got?
No. Do you have a magnifying glass or something like that?
Yeah, there's one here somewhere. Here.
Okay, now, look. Who is this man? Hmm? The one with his head down here in this picture and looking around in this one.
That's right. He was there just about every day. The paving contractor. Huh? Used to do all the work for the city.
Yeah, well, what's his name?
Owen Morse.
That's our man.
Mm-hmm.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Dead Man's Tale. I'm Rod Serling, and this is the Zero Hour. What was it that brought Carl Brooks back to his hometown? The gnawing guilt of having run from trouble? The love for a girl that he had but couldn't give with shadows on his conscience? Was it fate? In any case, he got more than he bargained for. His colleague and closest friend was dead, executed for a murder he could not have committed. To assuage his guilt, Carl Brooks took it upon himself to clear the name of the man he had failed to save. And in doing so, has begun to uncover a most complicated series of events, leading back to what really happened on the night 4 years before, the night Carl Brooks found an empty briefcase and a very quiet dead man. Dead Man's Tale will continue in a moment.
If Owen Morse was difficult to identify, locating him was next to impossible. His company was no longer in business, and his family had moved out of town. Hugo, a friend indeed, lent me his car and promised to have some repairs made on my rented one. It was dusk by the time I found Owen Morse's new home address. It was way out on Briar Street, next to the edge of town. A run-down old house converted into a triplex. He lived on the ground floor. For a man I suspected had once contributed many thousands of dollars for some kind of political sway, Owen Morse was living somewhat less than modestly.
Mr. Brooks, I've been waiting for you.
Waiting?
Waiting and watching. I knew you had to get to me sooner or later. And here you are. Come in, please.
Thank you.
Not exactly the kind of place you expected to find the ex-highly successful contractor living, is it? Sit down, Mr. Brooks. That chair is comfortable, despite its rather sad appearance.
Excuse me, but what did you mean, waiting and watching?
Joe Ferris called to warn me you'd returned and what you're trying to do. I didn't tell him I was delighted and looking forward to your success in finally pulling the lid off the whole stinking mess.
Wait a minute. I'm not sure I understand, Mr. Morris. If you're so anxious to have the truth known...
Why didn't I come forward with it on my own?
Yes.
I've thought about it a great deal. It would accomplish very little, particularly since I couldn't prove any of it. But I wasn't speaking of the truth about me, my contribution to that ill-starred special fund for Lloyd Mercer's re-election. That I freely admit. However, it will do little to assist you in clearing Barry Wilson's name, which is what I assume is your purpose. It's a certainty you've been unable to accomplish your goal by speaking to the other three.
How did you know about that?
I've been following your efforts since yesterday.
Oh.
But I am curious. How did you get to me?
I let your conscience be my guide.
Ah, yes. The cashier's checks. A shamefully insignificant contribution.
Yes. The checks and the fact that you were at Barry's trial every day. I won't ask you why you didn't come forward then. I mean, that's obvious.
Painfully so.
You see, Mr. Morris, Barry Wilson had one eyewitness to vouch for his innocence. That man was in California and couldn't be found.
That would be you.
That is correct. Painfully so. However, five men knew or had a pretty good idea what was in the briefcase Robert Henley had handcuffed to his wrist that night in the Delta Hotel.
Mm.
Barry Wilson was not one of them, nor was I.
Yes. Yes, I see the point. But if I killed Robert Henley, Mr. Brooks, the solution would be easy. I could simply come forward, admit it, and clear up everything, including my conscience.
Are you saying you didn't?
I didn't kill Robert Henley. I killed Barry Wilson. So I am a murderer.
Would you be willing to tell your story to the newspapers? To the police?
Oh, gladly. The proper time. But that would be a serious tactical blunder right now. Get the wind up with Mercer and Ferris, and they'll go after you in any way they thought would discredit you. Or silence you permanently. And it'd be no help to Ellen Wilson. And that's all I give a damn about anymore.
I have to admit that you've disarmed me. I anticipated some resistance, denials.
That's what you would have gotten 4 years ago.
What's changed?
You've heard of the wages of sin. What you see before you is the end result of the erosion of conscience. I stood by like the others in silence while Barry Wilson was rushed to the gallows. But I've paid my dues, as they say. And as you can see.
Well, you must have been a rich man. What happened?
No, never really rich. Well off, I guess. I wanted to be a business tycoon, on the stock exchange and all that. I might have made it, only I went about it the wrong way. What happened was the bottle. It helped me forget, one day at a time. I found I'd been an incipient alcoholic all my life. A year of steady drinking, lost weekends and then lost weeks and months, can quickly destroy even a sound business. The downhill slide is swift and accelerating. First my business and then my family. But the guilt doesn't go away. On the contrary, it grows.
It grows until the reason for it is rectified. And Mr. Morris, who killed Robert Henley?
I have no idea. I have nothing. My whole life is an utter waste of time.
Then why go on? You know, you sound like you could drink yourself to death if you tried.
Mr. Brooks, you see before you a gutless, impotent man. I've been on the wagon for 2 years now so I could hold down a job to make just enough to stay alive and send a few dollars to the woman I made a widow.
Mr. Morris, there seems to be more than enough guilt to go around for all of us. Speaking for myself, I'm willing to risk all to clear the slate, but I'm going to need your help.
You can count on me, Mr. Brooks. You can count on me.
I left Moss my number at the hotel in the event he had to reach me. I was disappointed that my theory about him had been wrong. But a man like that needed no assistance in inflicting self-punishment. Hugo wasn't at the office when I called, so I left a message for him not to print anything yet and that I'd be in touch. Though as of the moment, I was no further along in clearing Barry than when I had first started. It all added up to one big zero. Somehow, I had the feeling something was missing. like the slush fund, something obvious. I drove Hugo's car back to the Delta to see if I had any messages. It was a misty night, but not cool. I looked up into the sky, and the moon was barely a sliver. The stars, invisible. I tried to locate my room from the street below by counting it from the corner. I counted again. No mistake. That was my room with the lights on and the curtains puffed out the open window. I entered the lobby. The desk clerk was nowhere in sight. I got out on the fourth floor and took the stairs up one flight. The hall was clear. There was a crack of light between the bottom of the door and the carpet. I listened. Then, carefully, took out my key and slipped it in the lock. And... All right. What? Jenny. It was a toss-up as to who scared who more. Seeing Jenny there in my room was both a relief and an obstacle. I hadn't realized how much I had missed her, and yet she could only make matters more difficult by being so close. But I hid my ambivalence as best I could, and we spent the night together. In the morning, we had room service and a breakfast. It was then that I explained the situation. So that's about how it stands at this point, Jen.
Come home, Carl, please. You've done what you came for. You're a free man.
If it was only so simple. Jenny, you have no idea what effect this has had on the lives of so many people.
All right, but what about us, our lives? Suppose you do find out who killed that man. Then what?
Well, that's most of what I have to do.
There's more? Carl, you're driving yourself...
Barry's dead, but his family lives on.
You mean his wife and child, don't you? Ellen, isn't that her name?
Just some kind of benefits. I mean, a fund for Katie. Something.
Carl, are you telling me everything?
I don't know everything.
I mean about Ellen. What does she want from you?
Well, I suppose at this point she probably wants me to die or disappear. She's bitter, Jenny, and I don't blame her. She and I were close once. We were just kids. I was best man at a wedding.
Oh, Carl, it hurts me to see you like this. I came here to comfort you, to be with you. I know you didn't want me here, but I had to see you. Look, I'll go back to Coulter today if it's really what you want.
If I had a choice, Jenny, if I was really free...
Oh, please, don't say anything. I'll call the airport. I'll get it.
No, don't.
Hello? Oh, yes, he's here.
Hello. Hello, Judge. I'm just fine. How are you these days? Oh, you'd like to reconvene our discussion from the other night? Or just say when? In your chambers? Very good, Judge. I'll be there.
Carl, what's wrong? Why didn't you want me to answer the phone? Are you in trouble?
I have to meet with Judge Mercer about some dirty laundry. I'll be back this afternoon. We'll grab a bite and then I'll drive you to the airport. All right? Don't worry, Jenny. Remember, I love you. See you later.
Carl, please be careful.
I must see you about a matter of considerable importance, Lloyd Mercer had told me over the phone. The wheels were turning and I was botching up the mechanism. There wasn't much doubt as to what Mercer wanted to talk about. It was the particulars that aroused my curiosity. He was waiting for me in his chambers, all decked out in official garb.
Come in, Carl. Good of you to drop by.
You look very spiffy in your robes, Mr. Mercer. Judge.
Sit down, Carl. Can I get you something?
No, thank you. I only drink socially.
Really, Carl? So hostile. Carl, a matter of what I feel significant importance has been brought to my attention.
A matter that concerns me, Your Honor?
We've received some new information on the Henley murder. It points rather definitely toward your culpability.
Oh, really?
Apparently, there was an eyewitness.
Someone saw me kill Henley?
Not actually performing the act.
Let me guess. This eyewitness was Joseph Farris.
Splendid conjecture. He was out of town during the trial, and since I was the district attorney, he told me what he knew. Still, I couldn't believe that you'd killed Henley, and I told him so.
Your faith in me is nothing short of overwhelming, but what suddenly changed your mind?
Carl, you were a fugitive. A cogent fact relating to your guilt, if, of course, the case is reopened.
If?
Well, it's impossible to prosecute a man who can't be found. You know that as well as the next fugitive.
What if I stay?
Well, you could try to save yourself. Discrediting you would be ridiculously easy, and very likely prove to be a political bonanza for me. Anyone knows a man accused of murder is liable to say anything to save his skin. And the voters have a ready sympathy for public servants unjustly attacked.
Same old song, just different lyrics. I'd love to vocalize, Your Honor, but...
I thought you were smarter than that, Carl. I'm a much older hand at this sort of thing than you.
A point well taken.
I have a full calendar today, so I'm afraid you must be going. In parting, let me say, if you're still in the jurisdiction of this state tomorrow morning, be prepared to remain here, behind bars, for the rest of your life.
I knew if it ever came down to a test of strength between Mercer and me on his home grounds, I'd have no chance at all. Knowing Mercer, he could make a pretty good case for complicity between Barry and me to rob and murder Henley. Again, Mercer would come up smelling like a rose, and he had the savvy and muscle to make it stick. I still had that nagging suspicion of something right in front of my eyes that I wasn't seeing. But first, there was another fish to fry. As it was, the skillet was hot and greased and ready for me. To catch the fish was the real problem. That and bait.
Carl, that's crazy. That's suicide.
Either way, it gives you something to print. An expose or an obituary.
Treating Ferris like that is just asking for it. He'd dig the river to throw your body in. Lead shoes and all.
It's my funeral. Look, you go. Ferris killed Henley, or had him killed.
Setting yourself up this way isn't going to prove anything, Carl.
It will if he tries it again and misses, and somebody's there to see him, like a reporter.
Sorry, I don't want any part of this scheme.
Hugo, Mercer's trying to chase me out. He thinks I know too much.
Don't go after Mercer, Carl. That's really suicide.
All I'm after is the truth. I want to be able to sleep at night.
Keep this up and you'll sleep forever.
Look, I'm going through with it, Hugo. I'll ask you again when the time comes.
Carl, we got your car keys.
Carl? Yeah, forgot. Thanks. Unlike most night spots, the Farris wheel looked plush even by day. Joe Farris was finishing a late lunch on his private patio upstairs when I arrived.
How about a spot of coffee, Brooks?
No, thanks.
I can't believe you dropped in just to say goodbye.
Who's leaving?
Yeah, I figured you'd be dumb enough to stick around.
Mercer says you'd testify against me in court, but I have my doubts. The sword cuts two ways, and you know it.
You gotta be the cutest guy in town, Brooks.
If you saw me in Henley's room, I saw you. The next obvious question would have to be, what were you doing there? I will have a lawyer, of course, and there has to be a complete trial even in this state.
With Mercer in my corner, I'd take my chances.
I don't think you're going to let it come to that. I've got everything just about together now. All the details of who contributed to that fund for Mercer and what each of you were buying.
You're bluffing.
Am I? How did the names Clarence Lacey, Owen Morris, and Frank Irwin grab you?
You have been busy. But all they can supply is talk, no proof.
Enough talk to blow your sweet setup in this town sky high. And when I complete the angle I'm working on, I'll have enough evidence to pin Henley's murder on you and make it stick.
You're cute, all right, Brooks, but not very bright.
Maybe not. But I suggest you talk to the judge and tell him your eyesight isn't what it used to be. I'd think about it if I were you, Farris, or...
Or what, punk?
I'll see you in court.
Now the hook was baited. I just had to hope that the fish wouldn't strike before I was ready. I drove back to the hotel to get Jenny. I had to put her on a plane before the fireworks started. I parked the car and walked along the same sidewalk as the night before.
As I looked up towards my window again, I practically fell over a group of workmen sitting along the side of the building.
Hey, better watch where you're going, buddy. You might hurt yourself.
Yeah, sorry. At the desk, I stopped to see if I had any messages. There were two. One that Dr. Irwin phoned and left his number for me to call back. And the other was a note from Jenny. Dear Carl, I didn't want to make things harder for you than they already are, so I'm saying goodbye to you this way. I've taken a taxi to the airport and will be in Coulter sometime tonight. Don't worry about anything, darling. I understand what you have to do here. I'll be waiting for you when you come home. Love, Jenny. Somehow, that was wrong. Jenny's note. Something about it. I couldn't quite pin it down, but it bothered me. What was it about this whole thing I wasn't seeing? Henley's room, for one. Where did I go after I slugged Farris? Let me see. I ran out the door. This way. The stairs. Let's see. I ran down the stairs. To here. I turned this way, but if I'd gone straight.
Hey, here comes the bird watcher.
What's this? Where am I?
You want I should get you a map? This is the boiler room. You took another wrong turn, buddy. Can't let you out this way.
Metropolitan Airport.
I'd like to page Miss Jenny Duncan, please.
Paging Jenny Duncan.
Miss, when's the next flight to San Francisco?
9:15, sir.
Tonight?
9:15 tomorrow morning.
Well, when did the last flight leave?
9:15. There's only that one flight daily, sir.
They've got Jenny.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Dead Man's Tale. I'm Rod Serling, and this is the Zero Hour.